What's going on? Alex here, and today we're going to tackle Form 7203. We're going to take a look at the form, discuss what it's all about, and take a look at a few examples of what can happen when Form 7203 is not used properly or is omitted altogether. The consequences can be pretty significant. And with that, let's dive in and take a look at IRS Form 7203. And as you can see here, this is a wonderful 2022 edition before us. I would dare say that it's a beautiful tax form, but people tell me I've been doing this for way too long. I need a vacation. Maybe they're right. But as you can see, the name of the form is S Corporation Shareholder Stock and Debt Basis Limitations. Big fancy name, but at the end of the day, what we're tracking is S Corporation Shareholder Basis. Now, if you're not an S Corporation shareholder, Form 7203 will not apply to you. But if you have an ownership stake in an S Corporation, then Form 7203 may very well become a part of your personal tax filings moving forward. So as you look through the form here, you could see that it tracks shareholder stock basis. It also gets into shareholder debt basis all the way down here. And as you can see, it's fairly involved, but when you break it down into its component parts, you'll see that it's not all that scary. And you may look at your prior year tax returns and say, hey, wait a minute, I don't remember Form 7203 being part of my 2018 returns, 2019 returns, 2020, but all of a sudden in 2021 and 2022, it appeared as part of my Form 1040 or personal tax returns. What gives? Well, the reason behind that is that 7203 is a new form that the IRS came up with pretty recently. And we can see that here. If we look at the IRS website, you'll see the prior year forms and instructions. That Form 7203 came about in 2021. All right, so 2022 is just the second year of its existence. Now, looking at 7203, we see that it tracks basis, but we also saw that it only started to exist in 2021. So how did things work before tax year 2021? Well, that's kind of interesting because the basis calculation used to be part of a worksheet that was included with the Schedule K-1 instructions. So as we can see here for 2020, this is the year prior to the introduction of the 7203. This is the instructions for the Schedule K-1 for shareholders. And if we look down here, we'll see a worksheet for figuring a shareholder stock and debt basis, which if you look at the line items will look very familiar because it's very similar to what 7203 became. All right. So in those prior tax years, you had a worksheet that you had to work through and it has various sections. There's also this wonderful goodness and there's even more over here. And basically what happened was the IRS allowed shareholders to track basis under the honor system, if you could believe it, prior to tax year 2021. And the IRS had no idea what the basis was for the shareholders that had S Corporation shares. So basically, S Corporation shareholders were deducting massive amounts of losses, and the IRS had no idea if they were eligible to deduct those losses because the basis information was part of the accountant's work papers. It was a worksheet somewhere in a file, in a filing cabinet. The IRS did not require the filing of any basis information, so nobody filed it. And if there were losses that came in through the S Corporation, the shareholders deducted it all willy-nilly. And the IRS really didn't have any recourse. They said, we don't know how to verify this because we don't have the information. So in 2021, the IRS fixed that in making 7203 a mandatory filing for S Corp shareholders in many situations, not all, but many. So now S Corporation shareholders are forced to show their work and now they can't deduct all those losses all willy-nilly without having a basis, pun intended, for the deduction of those losses. Now you have to show your work and make the case that yes, I'm eligible to deduct these S Corporation shareholder losses because I have adequate stock and or debt basis. All right, so that's why 7203 was introduced. It's because prior to tax year 2021, S Corporation basis and loss deductions were managed under the honor system. We all know what happens when things are done under the honor system from a tax perspective, right? You get all sorts of shenanigans and people tell all sorts of fairy tales on the tax returns. So in 2021, this form was introduced and moving forward, you have to file 7203 as part of your tax return in certain situations. Let's take a look at the instruction for Form 7203, and you could see specifically when it's required to be filed. And we see here, this is for 2022. It says, who must file? And Form 7203 is filed by S Corporation shareholders who, one, are claiming a deduction for their share of aggregate loss from an S Corporation, including an aggregate loss not allowed last year because of basis limitations. Number two, received a non-dividend distribution from an S Corporation. Number three, disposed of stock in an S Corporation, whether or not gain is recognized, or received a loan repayment from an S Corporation. And there's a tip over here, which is good to note as well. It says it may be beneficial for shareholders to complete and retain Form 7203, even for years it is not required to be filed, as this will ensure their bases are consistently maintained year after year. So what the IRS is saying is that even if you don't meet any of those requirements to file Form 7203, it's still good practice to fill it out on an annual basis, because I can't tell you how many S Corporation shareholders out there have no idea what their basis is, and even more, have no idea that the concept of basis exists. And we're going to look in this video at a few examples of what can happen when you fail to track shareholder basis. It could be a pretty big disaster. So we've taken a look at the brief history of 7203. We gain an understanding of why it's required to be filed in many cases. But let's go back for a second and discuss basis a bit more. So as you can see, basis is essentially, it can be viewed as the skin in the game that you have as an S Corporation shareholder, at least on the very beginning. Now, S Corporation basis can be the topic of a college course in and of itself. It can get very, very complicated, and there are about 1,000 different iterations of how basis can be calculated. But if you take a look at it as skin in the game, you can imagine an S Corporation shareholder funding the S Corporation with $10,000, let's say. That becomes, in many cases, the shareholder's basis, all right? And basis increases through many different ways, but very commonly through income that passes through the S Corporation that'll increase your basis. Also, additional contributions that the S Corporation shareholder makes also increases the basis. On the other hand, basis decreases if you have losses that flow through from the S Corporation, or if you have distributions that are taken by the S Corporation shareholder. So there is an ordering process there in terms of the increases and decreases to basis, but that's pretty much how it works. And you need to track basis consistently, because really every transaction in the S Corp can change the S Corporation shareholder basis. But as a matter of convenience, usually it's updated on an annual basis. But that doesn't mean that something that happened mid-year won't affect the basis necessarily. It's really all of the transactions throughout the entire year, they are going to influence what the basis is at the end of the year. If you look through Form 7203, you'll see stock basis at the beginning of the year. So that's normally transferred from the prior year. It's the prior year ending basis, should be the current year beginning basis. Then we have basis from capital contributions made or additional stock acquired during the tax year. So additional money that the S Corporation shareholder contributed to the S Corp. They can also lend money to the S Corp for debt basis. That's covered on the bottom section of the form, but that's another way to increase basis. That would be debt basis. And then you can see ordinary business income is over here, and then all of these other factors, they would serve to increase basis. And now you have stock basis before distributions, and now distributions would lower the basis, right? So we have to make sure that if S Corporation shareholder takes distributions, they have adequate basis, or there could be a taxable event there, which would be in many cases undesirable. So we tend to avoid those when we can. And you can see here the other items that decrease basis. One good thing about the 7203 is that it actually gives you all the different line items that come into play. So it makes it very easy to track and see what's influencing your basis over time. And at the end here, we see the stock basis at the end of the corporation's tax year. And once you go through all the calculations, you'll see where you end up there. Similar process happens for the shareholder debt basis. And we also have the allowable loss and deduction items there in part three, which again, get into more specifics, and we'll take a look at how this all works a little bit later. But the importance of tracking basis is for a multitude of reasons. Basis will influence what losses you can deduct, all right? So essentially, if you have, let's say, $150,000 in losses that flow through from the S corporation, the question of whether you can deduct any of that at all has to do first with basis. And the problem is, especially before tax year 2021, is that individuals who were preparing their own returns had no idea what their basis was. So they were deducting hundreds of thousands of dollars. I've seen examples of this without tracking basis at all, which could be a huge issue. And often it happens when the S corporation acquires debt, all right? So they borrow funds and then they start distributing those funds out, and the losses are in many cases not deductible. So you want to make sure that that's tracked on an ongoing basis. The other thing is, if you dispose of your S corporation share, so if you sell your shares, the first question is, what is your basis? Because in many cases, that's going to determine the gain or loss on the disposition of those shares. That's why you have to track it consistently year over year, because from the very first day to the very last day that you hold those shares, basis is going to change every single year. And you need to stay on top of it, because if you stop tracking it in 1 year, it's difficult in many cases to catch it up in future tax years. And you may lose out on some losses that you could have deducted, or you may pay more in gains simply because your tax preparer can't calculate your basis. The information is just not there. So what we did was put together a few examples here of how the losses from the S corp and basis all play into the actual tax returns, because that's where the meat and potatoes really is. We could talk about theory all we want, but at the end of the day, applying it to an actual tax return, I think will make a lot of these concepts much clearer. So we have five different scenarios here that we're going to look at. And as you can see, we have scenario one, which is going to serve as a baseline scenario. And we're just going to assume $300,000 in wages with nothing else going on. And you'll see that we want to figure out what the federal tax liability is going to be and what the S corporation loss carryover to tax year 2023 is going to be. So right now we're working tax year 2022. The next year would be 2023. So let's go to the tax software and let's see how scenario one plays out. And you'll see here we have basically a blank tax return. We haven't really done anything to it yet. A single filing status and not much else happening. So let's enter some wages here of $300,000. All right. So we'll take a look at the 1040 and we should see here that we have $300,000 in wages, not much else going on. We're not introducing the S corporation factors just yet. We'll get there. And we can see here, we have the standard deduction. All that looks good. And the total tax is $75,121. So let's track that, because we want to track the differences in every different scenario that we're going to apply here. And the S corporation loss carryover to tax year 2023 doesn't exist. If we look on the general information tab, we haven't really entered anything for the S corporation just yet. So carryovers to 2023, we have none. All right, that makes sense. So we're going to enter zero there. Now, let's take a look at scenario number two, where we have wages and S corporation losses, no basis information entered into the tax software. Okay, that's going to be a key point here. So we have $300,000 in wages, no difference there. And now we're going to input $100,000 in S corporation flow through net loss. This is a Schedule K-1 net loss of $100,000. All right, so let's get back into the software. We're going to keep the wages the way they are. And in the S corporation section, we're going to put an ordinary loss of $100,000. Okay. So if we go to the tax return, we have the $300,000 in wages. We have $100,000 in the loss from the S corp. That's coming from Schedule E. All right. And in this case, we're not taking into account passive loss limitations. There are actually a number of limitations that come into play to determine whether you can deduct losses. There's basis, there's at risk, there's passive loss limitations, there's excess loss limits, there are net operating loss limitations. So there are a whole number of limitations. We're just looking at basis right now, just to not make this too crazy. So $100,000 is coming from Schedule E, and it's all being deducted here because we could see that the total income is $200,000. So we have $300,000 wages minus $100,000 in losses. We get $200,000 in total income. Once we take the standard deduction into account, we have $187,050 in taxable income, and the total tax is now $40,988. Okay, and let's take a look at the S corporation loss carryover in this case, and you can see that it's none. All right. So we just saved $34,133. What a great outcome, right? Wrong. Because a huge mistake we made here is that we never entered basis information for this S corporation share. So what the software did was assume that basis did not play into this situation, which is never the case. This amount would probably be incorrect simply because we did not factor any basis information into this return whatsoever. All right. Now in scenario three, we're going to address that. Okay. So now we're going to assume same situation as scenario two, but we're going to enter zero basis for the S corporation at the end of the year. Okay. And you may ask yourself, how can someone have zero basis in their S corp share? Well, they could have had losses in prior tax years, and basis can't go below zero. So zero is the lowest basis you can have. Or they might have taken distributions in prior tax years. So there could be a whole number of reasons why basis is zero. It is a realistic outcome. So this isn't an outlier situation necessarily. In scenario three, we're going to take a look at what happens when we enter zero basis in this case, with everything else being unchanged. So let's go into the tax software, and you'll see that there is a place here to enter basis information. All right. And I wish it was more obvious, but you really have to know where it is to look for it. And in your tax software, if you're using something like TurboTax, you need to know to look for it as well. All right, so stock basis at the beginning of the year, you see that it's mandatory. And if we want to put zero basis or none, we'll put -1 here. Okay, so we'll put -1. All right, so now we're telling the tax software that beginning basis is zero. And essentially ending basis is going to be zero too, because there's no income, there's no contributions throughout the year. Now, let's go to the tax return. See if you can guess how things have changed. Now, we have the total wage income, $300,000. We didn't change that. And you could see here that there is no loss from the S corp. Whoa, what's happening? This is different now. And then Schedule E, you see, is blank as well. No loss. What's going on? In this case, Form 7203 isn't even being included with the tax return, but we can see here on the basis limitation worksheet what's happening. So you can see that the stock basis at the beginning of the year is zero. Stock basis at the end of the year is zero. Same with debt basis. And the current year loss or deduction is $100,000. And the regular tax amount allowed by basis is zero. So none of that loss is being allowed. You see what huge difference it made to enter a basis of zero as opposed to no basis information? The tax software went from not taking basis into account at all to realizing that, oh my God, none of that loss is deductible. Zero, absolutely nothing. And you can see the basis carryover is $100,000. So in 2022, the S corporation shareholder, given that their basis is zero, gets absolutely zero deduction for that S corporation loss. So let's go to the tax return. And we can see here that, again, the total tax is $75,121. Okay. And the S corporation loss carryover to tax year 2023 is $100,000. All right. So you can see here, these are the differences that came about both in terms of federal tax liability and the loss carryover just by entering the information. So scenario three is just like scenario two, except that we did not omit the basis information in scenario three. That's the difference that it can have in terms of what the tax liability may be. So you can see we're comparing it to scenario two. Huge implications. So you have to be careful that your tax software is actually tracking basis and it's only allowing the losses that are allowable in your situation. Zero basis, zero losses allowable. All right, let's keep on trucking. And if you guys are enjoying the video, if you're getting value out of it, like the video, subscribe to the channel, share it. Leave a comment. I love reading your comments. And from there, we're going to move into scenario four. Now, we're going to keep the wages the same. We're going to keep the loss the same. But now we're going to incorporate a shareholder basis of $10,000. And we're going to see how that affects the return. See if you can guess how things are going to change. So we could start off with zero basis in the beginning. And let's say the S corporation shareholder contributed $10,000. This would be cash that the S corporation shareholder put into the S corporation account. And let's see what happens. All right, let's just make sure we're not missing anything. Okay. All righty. So now, if we take a look at the return, first of all, let's start with 7203 because now it popped up because we saw in the instructions earlier that it's not required in all cases, but in this case, it will be required because we're meeting the criteria for the actual filing of 7203. So we see here a stock basis at the beginning of the year is zero. Then we have basis from capital contributions made during the tax year is 10,000. This is the S corporation shareholder putting more funds in. And then we have stock basis before distributions 10,000. And you can see here, since there are no distributions, we make it all the way down here. And we can see here that we have the allowable loss and deduction items is 10,000. So we had 10,000 in S corporation shareholder basis as of the end of the year. We have 10,000 in losses that we're taking. And you can see on Schedule E, the number here is 10,000. That's because of the basis limitation. Remember, 100,000 flow through on the S corporation K1. We're only taking 10,000 of that because that's all we have the basis to take. Alrighty. So back to 7203, we see the stock basis at the end of the tax year is zero because we've exhausted all of it. And on the 1040, we can see that there's still 300,000 in wages. There's just 10,000 in terms of the losses from the S corp. And we look at the total tax, it's 71,621. Okay. Now, what do you guys think is going to be the carryover of the loss from the S corporation from tax year 2022 to 2023? Now, if you said 90,000, you would be correct. All right. And if we take a look at the general information tab, we see that the basis losses are 90,000. They're being carried over to 2023 and they can be used when the S corporation shareholder increases their basis one way or another. There are a few ways to do it. Like I said, they can contribute additional funds. There could be income that comes in from the S corp that increases their basis, or they can lend money to the S corp. There are a few different ways to do it. But that's essentially the point, is that you can deduct up to your basis until it hits zero. The rest is carried over to the future tax year, all right? And you can see how these numbers are flying around depending on whether we're including any sort of basis information. And you can see that the differences are pretty significant from year to year. All right, so let's input this 90,000 S corporation carryover. And let's take a look at scenario five. All right, so we're gonna keep the wages the same. We're gonna keep the loss at 100,000, but now we're going to give the basis of 100,000 to the shareholder, and we're going to see what happens in that situation. All right, so we can either have a beginning basis of 100,000, or we can just contribute 100,000 throughout the tax year. So we're going to go with that. Now back to 7203, we see that the 100,000 is being reflected, but we can also see here that the allowable loss is now the full 100,000. All right, and what do you think is making it to Schedule E? If we take a look, you'll see that we have 100,000 on Schedule E. So now we have adequate basis to take the full amount of the loss, and we're taking the loss on Schedule E, and it's making its way to the Form 1040, and you can see that it's reducing taxable income dollar for dollar. So the limitation is not kicking in because the basis is equal to the amount of losses. You're able to take the whole thing. And if we look at the general info, we see that the carryovers to 2023 are none. All right, so the full loss was able to be deducted. Now, really quickly, let's take a look at the total tax. So $40,988. All right, and the loss carryover we could see here is zero. All right, so hopefully that provides some insight, and you can see the differences here are pretty significant depending on whether or not you forget to put the basis information, or if you have inadequate basis or adequate basis. Either way, it's important to track. I know I have many clients that come over from other tax firms or preparing their returns themselves, and they have hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars of improper deductions that they should not have taken had they tracked their basis. And whereas before, a lot of this was under the honor system, so it was very difficult for the IRS to wrap their minds around it and catch taxpayers who may be playing games in this area. But now it's absolutely crucial to stay on top of it. Well, it was crucial before, it's still crucial now, but now you're having to show your work via Form 7203 to the tax authorities. And you can bet that they're going to be looking at this very closely, because all those hundreds of thousands and millions of dollars of deductions now have to flow through this form before they can be applied to the tax return, which is going to result in some surprises to some of the S corporation shareholders out there that are used to just taking any loss as it comes. Now there are limitations that are going to kick in, and you need to do your homework on the basis tracking side to make sure that you don't file tax returns that gain more attention than they should. And with that, if you're struggling with Form 7203, if you're pulling your hair out, we can help, all right? Efros Financial provides a full suite of accounting, tax, and financial planning services to make sure that your business runs well, make sure that your financials are tight, because tight is right, all right? And if you enjoyed this video, like the video, subscribe to the channel, do all those YouTube-y things, leave a comment down below, and if you leave an interesting comment, I might make a video about it, just like this one. And with that, hopefully this was helpful. Thanks for watching.